Good afternoon. Thank you everyone for coming to the second of our St. Thomas Historical Trust's St. Thomas Historical Trust preservation lecture series. A month ago we had David Knight Sr. give his speech, which was about the preservation conundrum. And David Bornn, who Esquire, who has been very instrumental in the his efforts and work with DRI, with Downtown Revitalization Inc. Basically going through all of the hurdles and problems associated with conforming to all of the guidelines and as far as what we need to do for to make things happen and make it a viable thing for downtown. So without any further ado, here is David Bornn, our best speaker for the day. Thank you, David.
Yay, David.
Thank you. And so good to see all of you, friendly faces. And first of all, thank you to the Trust for inviting me.
Is that all that's
I consider myself very fortunate in that I was not only raised in a historic home, but my family, all of my family, grandparents down, had a sense of community passion. And whether you may know this or not, I was not only a member of the historic trust, but I was also president for a period of time. And most importantly, for purposes of what we're going to talk about today, I feel very pleased and honored to be a member of a community with a very deep history that many of us may or may not understand fully and appreciate, but with a history of a distinctive sense of self and civilization and architecture and appearance. And it is that uniqueness of our town and our harbor that I think we need to endorse and to resuscitate to make sure that it continues to live. Now, I've been asked to address the interaction of preservation and revitalization. And I'll start off, and by the way, this is all very freewheeling. I just have a couple of notes, and wherever I don't capture something, please jump in. I have no particular program. But one thing that I will say is that at times when I try to match preservation and revitalization, I sometimes get into what I would call irreverence. And I may come from the historic trust background with preservation. Preservation and revitalization are not always compatible. And it is not that anyone is disrespectful of the other. But the fact is that revitalization has a certain different twist of bringing the town back to life, sometimes at whatever cost, as opposed to preservation, which tries to be strict in its application. This particularly comes through if you are rehabilitating, renovating a home under the Secretary of Standards. You have a lot more structured guideline than if you do it on the basis of, I want it to simply look good. And the fact, one of the abiding things that we have to consider is that in revitalization, is that if the community doesn't care for itself, then you have to ask the question of who will. And I also pose the question that where do we start? Do we start in thinking in terms of attraction of tourists, or do we think in terms of attraction of residents and quality of our life? And I think the way we have approached it in downtown revitalization, which I will refer to as DRI, is that we must look at ourselves first. And the quality of preserving the quality of life or enhancing the quality of life for ourselves, and what makes sense to us, what helps us, will follow in terms of what makes for an island experience for a visitor. This has come through over and over as we more recently have gone into a new phase of program at DRI, where we are trying to deal with the things that are of immediate attention to turn around the economic as well as the physical vitality in the town. We have gone into a program of looking at of revising and restructuring the business model of how we do business in the downtown. And that was engendered from a conversation with the Hotel Association. And the question I was getting on one, not the question, the bawling, the moaning, and the complaining I was getting on the one side from merchants is that we're not getting business. And on the other hand, I'm getting a conversation with the hotels saying we would like to send our people downtown. The merchants saying, well, we don't get people from the hotels and the villas. And on the opposite side, I have villas and hotels saying, yes, we want to send people downtown. What is the disconnect here? The disconnect is in terms of commitment and wanting to do something and doing it to meet the goal of, again, not satisfying the hotels per se, but is satisfying ourselves. And what is it that we as residents would find attractive to go downtown? And the Hotel Association gave me a list of things that would make that possible. Not in any particular order, but the most compelling point was security. Followed by a variety of shopping and things to do. Followed by the attractive appearance of the town. Followed by consistency in what we do. Don't have an event in 1 month, say you're going to have it every month, and fail to follow through. The same thing in terms of incorporation of the elements of food and beverage, restaurants and entertainment. And when you come down to it, and when we started putting this plan together, we found that there was really no paucity of things to do in town. And also of entertainment. But we don't keep it with a sense of consistency, and we have a very important one of the key elements, the first element on the list, security. Do we feel secure going downtown? So I say that to wrap in a couple of other points. We need to look at revitalization hinges on some actually very simple points. First is protecting our cultural and economic survival. While this is an element where preservation and revitalization come together. And if we don't protect our, first of all, our culture and our history, there's nothing and nobody who's going to come and try and rescue it and tell you what a pretty place you have. And on the other hand, economic survival is our doing things that will not will hit, go back to the element of quality of life, but also the quality of the island experience. We live here because it's an island, it has a different way of being, so too visitors come for an island experience. Well, we've got to give it to them. First of all, we've got to give it to ourselves. Now, touched with that, and this is where we begin to veer away from preservation, is practicality. The fact is that while it is very nice to enter into preservation activity according to strict guidelines, it is also sometimes impractical and requiring strict adherence to preservation guidelines may be much more expensive to the homeowner that you're encouraging, you're seeking to encourage to revitalize their building, to make it an attractive appearance for the overall attraction of the town. Now, brings me to a sort of simple view that if every homeowner, every building owner in the entire downtown, and I reference as in for us downtown is from Frenchtown to Havansett, from the harbor to the foothills. It is not a main street. But if we all, each building owner, took a sense of urgent pride in maintaining the building, the environment around the building, and including the government, because I had a conversation with the new Commissioner of Property and Procurement, who comes out of a property management background. The government being the largest landholder in the town, if the government used its buildings for government purposes or even perhaps private purposes, but if they populated their properties with departments, offices, downtown, it has the domino effect that if you have people coming to do business with the government, you have then a reason for them to want other services in town. You have government workers that then also need things in town, whether it's restaurants or laundromats or daycare centers. And in turn, if services of the government are in town, you then have other private businesses that would want to locate in town. Now,
what did he say?
He, thank God, he understood the concept. He said that this is something he would very much look into. Now, here's one of the other things that really is a pet peeve of mine, and then basically how DRI came into being. DRI came into being, if you don't know, out of a conversation of six of us who sat down and said, this has got to stop. We've got projects the government says are going to happen, and it's been 20, 25 years and they haven't happened. Or you have things that the government says they are going to do, like, yes, they're going to put the buildings downtown, and they don't happen. My pet peeve is You cannot, as a private sector, stand and wait for the government to lead us in the things it's supposed to lead us on, or you're going to be standing there for a long time. And hence, the premise, one of the principal premises of revitalization and DRI is we, individuals, private persons, businesses, must grab hold of the steering wheel of the boat and drive it. The government will come in behind us, hopefully, but we cannot wait. For instance, DRI and Chamber will take full credit, as we should, along with the Dreamhouse Foundation and the Community Foundation, yeah, for enabling the movement that has occurred on the Main Street Enhancement Project and the Water Fair. Now, granted, yes, not a shovel has been turned, but the fact is that there are reasons for both shovels not being turned. On Main Street, it's because there's an annoying piece of litigation that blocks the start. However, the fact that those plans have occurred, have come to be, and most importantly, because the plans originally were only for Main Street, we said, well, what about the side streets and back street? And what about the fact that you're doing streetscape? What about the underground utilities? Are you going to tell us you're going to do this wonderful paving and enhancement with the palm tree, with the trees and the benches, and then we're going to come back and rip it up for sewer and electric and telephone and the broadband? So DRI did what it does best. It facilitated. It brought in and had a conversation. Smart move by somebody. Had first a conversation with each separate government agency. What are they doing? Got those answers. And the answers didn't match. Because they said that so-and-so was coordinating. And then brought them together. And literally in front of our eyes, we could see the complete disharmony of the agencies. WAPA was going to start their project at the post office. Public Works was starting the project at the Market Square. But had in budget, thank God, the underground utilities at the West End, at the Market Square end, did not have budgeted utilities at East End. And WAPA only had money for a limited portion of the post office end through FEMA funds. So lo and behold, right in front of us, we managed to get them to actually work out an understanding and agreement as to who was going to do what where. And also at the table, we had Innovative, Waste Management, and Tourism. Because if we're going to do this project, Lord help us if we just go and rip things up and not put out word that the town is under construction. We managed to get everybody holding hands together, agreeing, cooperating, and in point of fact, when WAPA finished its eastern portion, has now finished the western portion as well. We even had the Department of Tourism engaged to do announcements in the industry, and they're to do that going forward. Now, what all of these projects have started, but by no means Is it enough? Is another important element we must have, and that is community engagement. This has been the most frustrating part of DRI. You get pockets of people who care, who give, who get involved. But the mission of revitalization is not for a few people. It is for the entire community. And it isn't a downtown thing. As I try to say, explain to people at Red Hook, you should have as much interest in downtown revitalization as you do in Red Hook revitalization, economic life in Red Hook. Because if we can get a parking scenario situated in downtown, and I have a meeting at Red Hook, I shouldn't be in fear and trepidation of losing my parking space downtown to go see you or to go shop and come back, or vice versa, if I'm a Red Hook person and I have to go to town and I'm in fear and trepidation, where am I going to park? Much less, I won't even throw in the element of security. So, total community engagement is required. Now, another simple element that we seem to gloss over is plain common decency. You can't legislate decency. You just have to have it. But if we don't have it, and we have to have it not just for ourselves, but for our visitors, the visitors won't return. We may put up with it. Visitors won't. There are other islands, there are other places in the world that they can go to. Now, coming back to this community concept, what the mission of DRI is, and the brochure that we passed around, has the mission of the whole revitalization effort, is compatible with every business, every organization in this community, every individual. The elements are, it incorporates historic preservation, it incorporates environmental, it incorporates plain business development, it incorporates entertainment, it even incorporates my good friends, film. It can act as a backdrop for the developing film business as well. DRI, in this concept, acts as the umbrella, bringing all of these organizations, people, businesses together. That's what DRI does best. And what has been interesting, just as I mentioned about the government agencies coming together and having a conversation and working things out, the fact is that DRI has been able to bring together an umbrella of varying organizations, many of which would not necessarily be engaged in revitalization or much less talking to each other. Example. What would AARP have to do with revitalization?
Barrier free.
In part. Simple things like that. We're bringing people, because, you know, why would AARP otherwise sit down and talk with Chamber of Commerce or, here's another grand coalition. The Barker's Bill, which seems to have a life of its own, brings together the Chamber of Commerce, the Historic Trust, Megan's Bay Authority, Hotel Association, the Realtors Association. All of these, not necessarily organizations that talk to one another on an individual basis. Think of that. Now, the new model for solutions to revitalization is essentially the old model. But it has become more pronounced because of budgetary restraints. And that is the point that I was raising before, that government cannot be the answer or the leader. And while government has its own missions and involvement, particularly as the largest landholder in downtown, we are never, ever going to see the government take the lead or do what it's supposed to. The only way the government is going to function in the revitalization and preservation effort is to be brought along kicking and screaming. And it's no spite on any particular administration. Governor Matheson, he's engaged in this. He's supportive of revitalization. But if we were to take that word and try to back it, I don't think we'd get much money out of that. So, pure and simple, the model has to be private sector takes control, drives the boat. And those things that we can do as a private sector, small and big, we must do. There are certain things that are not within our control because they require governmental functions. But those things that we can do, we must do. In particular, as individuals, we really have to do for ourselves. We just have to seize the initiative and do those things that we want to get done. Now, that's where I come back to the point of practicality, is that in doing revitalization in concert with preservation, and we have gotten good cooperation on this from the Historic Preservation Commission, is recognizing that there are certain elements of deviant from strict guidelines that are permissible, necessary, if we are to promote revitalization. A big concern that everybody said, well, yes, I want to restore my house, I want to make it attractive. But I got two problems. One is the money. Where do I get the funding? Number two, the guy next door to me with that house that's falling down or is being used for other illegal purposes, how do I function in this neighborhood? Even if I do put money into the house, how am I A, going to get tenants, or B, sell it? And so you have this repeated over and over. But again, if each of us grabs hold of the next person and brings them along to the mission of revitalization, sure enough, those numbers will make a community, a whole community. And it's not just individuals. Bring along organizations, bring along businesses. Now, we have some problems, major problems, that we have to overcome in this effort. And I don't say that we have the answer. It's something that I'm leaving to the next board. One, how do we get individuals, businesses, organizations, churches, schools engaged and caring in the revitalization of their own town? Second, how do we get individuals, businesses, communities, churches to think in terms of community? That we all live here together. And by living here together, we project an image for our visitors. It's a good place to live. It's attractive. It has dynamics. Third, how do you take 1, 2, 3, 4 persons, businesses, organizations by the hand and drag them, as I say, probably kicking and screaming, into revitalization concept? But it has to be done. If we don't, then will somebody please turn the light switch off? Who's the last person to leave the airport? One last point. You can become engaged, first, if you haven't already, although I know a lot of you are, with this concept, bringing 1, 2, 3 people with you to the annual meeting of DRI, which is on Saturday, May 23rd. It starts at 8:30 and run and incorporates an informational forum in the meeting on some very important topics. On one, on the government sector portion, they will have an update on the infrastructure projects. We hopefully will hear from the horse's mouth, from the governor and his team, what they are doing and when. And secondly, on the private sector side, a part that I'm very, very happy to help push along is a discussion of what do we do to restructure, revitalize the business model for doing business in downtown so it is attractive to us as residents and to our visitors. Then that means we have multiple compartments. And it will incorporate, for those who always ask me the same question, how do I finance, how do I fund these efforts? There will be a component about how you can get the economic incentives to do these efforts. Are there any questions?
David, I thought that I heard Governor Mapp say that the Main Street project that got stopped by this pesky little litigation thing, I thought I heard him say that he had that resolved and we would start construction at the end of May. I heard wrong?
We were hopeful that he was going to do that, to resolve. And that, yes, the project could have started this week. To my knowledge, that has not been resolved. So, hopefully, that is one of the big questions I pose to him, is will you be able to tell us when this is going to start? And if you haven't seen it, by the way, the Market Square is what is going to be carried forward to Main Street. So that appearance, that general appearance, will now be the traverse all the way to the square.
And did he say he would carry that forward? That he was going to pursue it?
Oh, all right. What is really annoying about all this is that all of these projects, everybody asks the question: is it funded? Yes, the Main Street project is funded.
What is the litigation issue?
The losing bidder challenged the award.
Your challenge?
The losing bidder project.
Oh. Yes, sir.
That was my question.
What is the pesky little problem?
Yeah.
Nobody wants to just spit it out.
There are no pesky little problems in litigation, in my experience. They're always difficult and complicated and expensive.
So David, we appreciate your commitment to this and your tireless efforts, as you know. Now, as a private citizen, as a posse of 10 or 20 people, aside from falling into that big hole of just caring and throwing money and these other kinds of things, what's an action plan?
Well, there are a number of things that, and I'm going to identify those at the meeting. We have a whole working plan where everyone can get involved according to whatever sector of the plan you want. But some of it is money, some of it is simply hands-on. A lot of it is pulling together people working on particular issues and drilling it into the public. I mean, for instance, great example, the source and the data news both came forward committed to assisting where they can, not as newspapers per se, but in what can they do to try to mobilize the community. You know, what can they do in terms of reporting, but in a, and next day I see this report in the newspaper meeting. So I called up Jason. I said, "Now look, this was not intended for publication, and I was not aware that it was there. I appreciate the fact that you're intending to give us coverage, but there are things that you can do not in a reporting vein." And that's where it started. And so, on a non-reporting basis, they, Daily News and the Source, are both supporters in terms of helping in the committee process of how do we move the community. So is that, there are a variety of things. I mean, for me to just sort of list down, but it's that kind of thing where, and not everybody can do all, you know, it's not that we're asking everybody to do all these things. It's pick a thing that you're happy to work with. And for instance, the taxi, one of the taxi organizations, has signed on to help with the enabling more cost-effective transportation for the hotel guests. Hotel and villa guests, and charter boat guests, but they're actually, and there's another interesting thing, organizations voluntarily coming forward to say they want to be in part of this effort. Everybody focused on the hotels, but they're villa guests, and very importantly, they're a charter boat guest. And Charter Boat Association has stepped forward to say, we want to direct people to the town.
Well, maybe there's a, you know, since you have the media and some help there, maybe, you know, at some point after you get the presentation, you have an ad or something that says, do you want to help our make our community strong? Or down to whatever. And maybe it says, you know, the mission, like pop plants on this, I don't know. And then it says, call this number. And then it's number two, like this, you know, because people then could pick the things that, I mean, everybody wants to do everything, you know, but the fact of it is you're looking for people to push each goal. So maybe you're listing not goals, but action.
Action.
And then say, you know, this is who you call for this, and this is his phone number. This is who you call for this. If this is something that's really you know, the taxi fare thing. If this is something that's really important to you, you want to participate in that. Maybe you have that list of people, maybe you have that list of phone numbers so that somebody like that reads the source could pick it up and say, you know what, that's the committee that I'd like to participate on, because I think it is sort of overwhelming for no matter how much money or how much time anybody has, I think the whole process is a little overwhelming.
I had just one specific question that really bothers me. As you're coming into the center of town, turning into where the Vendors Plaza is, there's that government building right on the corner, one of the more prominent buildings, that I'm not sure which agency now, we were having a conversation back here, who owns it or controls it, but let's get the government.
District Court building.
The old District Court building. It looks like hell. I mean, it's... Let's get the government to just sell it. Let the private sector do it. You know, having them develop it is probably, or revitalize it is probably not a viable proposition. But I don't know if you might know something about that. But the other thing is, I think this warrants this whole effort that so many people, and particularly you, have put into this warrants an administrative entity that's there all the time. I mean, everything is done volunteer. There's no central office. There's no central distribution of information. There's nobody there who's a point person that you can call up any time. I mean, we've got a representative administrator for Water Island. What does that person have to do? Not very much. And I think we ought to have the equivalent of a mayor for downtown. Ombudsman.
I'll stop you right there. If we suggest another public sector office,
I'm an official mayor. I don't want it to be a political figure.
There is something in the works, and your point is well made. All of these activities do take a lot of time, and they require constant time, which when you have a volunteer organization is inconsistent. The fact is that as these things grow, and as I said, the basic premise I work on is I'm not going to the government sector for a solution. We have to do it privately. So, first of all, on the organization level, there needs to be an administrative officer, an executive director. But that executive director is going to have to pick up the additional projects that we're now beginning to roll with. If this working plan does effectively go into action, that will be, as you're suggesting, an organization that is comprised of all of the businesses in the downtown contributing to the services, contributing to enable and control the services that have to be entered into to make this plan work. For instance, a private security force. That is one of the items on the plan. And we have, you know, when you ask what are the things people can do, one of the sectors of the committees of the group have been tasked with figuring out what are the options, what are the costs to implement a private security system. Now, I was challenged that is that going to be a substitution for the police? No. It's in supplementation. But if you don't know already, there is not sufficient police manpower to do the things that we expect of the police for the downtown. It's just not possible on any reasonable day. And the only way, coming back to the concept private sector takes care of itself, if we implemented a boots on the ground camera, multifaceted security system, it would not only give us the peace of mind that there's something there, but we control it. And one of the perfect questions that was thrown at me that I enjoyed was, for instance, if a security officer isn't doing their job, they're all standing on the corner in front of 8 Stern watching the traffic go by, you can fire them. We control the group. We don't have to go to the police commission and ask, can you do something about these people? The same way, it doesn't necessarily require foot power. The systems that we've been looking at engage the property owners to mount, this is their contribution, is to mount cameras on their buildings that...
And they have decided to put it. You're going to have a private security firm monitor that whole area?
Johansen already has its own.
Yeah, but I'm talking about, but then you give examples that it's like, something to carve out or something like that. It sounds to me like you're really only concerned about your main business district.
I'm using that as the core example.
And then maybe neighborhood watches.
They have those too. For instance, Garden Street neighborhood has its own plan. They are also concerned about security. And they want to tie in their system with what goes on Main Street and Yachthaven. The same way we are trying to engage Frenchtown, that they have a security system there, a security officer that runs around Frenchtown. Tie that into the remaining parts of the system. It's not that we're leaving anybody out, but it's how. Now, these days, we don't have to have those feet on the ground to have connectivity. The connectivity comes through electronic means. And that electronic means permits us to capture a whole larger area than just Main Street. And this is not something that we're fabricating. This is something that has been used and proved in other communities where they have used an electronic system to engage, to capture their criminal element, and the footage has resulted in convictions. It's been used here as well. There have been cases here for instance, the robbery at Imperial.
Mm-hmm. At where?
Imperial Jewelers. The cameras, the camera footage, was part of the evidence that convicted those people, in addition to having their own masks and things on.
And let me point out to David. The Dutch Reformed Church, you all may not know this, covers quite a bit of area downtown with excellent camera work. All of Crystal Garter, Don Nye Garter, Sarah Garter covered some. And I had a situation in my building that was captured by 2 cameras monitored by the Dutch Reformed Church. The police had to go to them for the footage. We didn't go to the police. As opposed to many, many years ago, the police put up a camera right outside my building to cover the synagogue area. And something occurred one time. There was a police monitoring camera. They had no record. So I'm not going to name the company that's working with the Reformed Church. I'm a DIY, but they're coming to the table, so it's working.
I think all this is good, and I think in your interpretation, and when you approach the public, you need to expand on that public. because the only other time I heard you press this was at the Grand Hotel. And I walked away with the same impression that I approached you with just now, that your plan did not seem to be inclusive for our town. And I think that if you're going to appeal broadly and get more consensus for your plan, you need to make sure that when you address the public, you stress those partnerships and how broad you're thinking.
Well,
well, if we got one part great, then we would roll out the one part we got great. So we really have to get so big, honestly, that we can't.
Yeah, because in order to get everybody on your program, you've got to appeal to a lot of people.
I see. Good question.
I had a question. So, for a while there, I knew you were talking about using kind of events and festivals to spur interest in DRI. The last thing that I heard about was the, I think it was Valentine's Day weekend, you had an event. Can you give us an update on how that went or what the reaction to that was? Because I didn't hear anything about it after it happened.
That event was probably my lowest moment in DRI. A lot of effort was put into making it a success, and a lot of connections were made. It brought together a variety of people. But two factors, the funding for all of the entertainment and other things, and weather, combined to make it a non-starter. It started. It actually had some elements of very good success for about the first half hour. And then the skies opened and everything scrambled. But the more debilitating element was the fact that we did this on the premise that we were trying to assist business coming to town for the merchants. And while there were some very engaged merchants, the majority did not engage. And the whole point of the exercise was not just to bring people to town, but to bring the concept together that we have to think more creatively and flexibly in how to do business. And you can't do business from 9 to 5 and close the doors at 5 and expect to thrive if the people that you're targeting are on island overnight guests who during the day are probably, or residents, who during the day the overnight guests are probably doing other things, going sailing or beaching or Carl World or whatever. They don't want to go shopping at 9 a.m. They want to go shopping at 4 or 7. And as much as I try, not me, as much as the committee tried to bring that concept to the business community, it has hit a brick wall. And I am hoping that this summer's dive off the wall will reverse that thinking. That people come to realize there's only shifts, in some weeks there's only shifts on Mondays and Tuesdays. So, and you'll hear me say this at the end of the meeting, I'm not afraid to offend other people on this point, because I am offended that people don't buy in for their benefit. So what do you do on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday? Do you close the door because there are no cruise ships in port? When I've got people telling me there is a 72 to 92% occupancy at the hotels, and the villa trade people are telling me that they've got a good summer going, not just here, but in St. John, and those same villa companies are willing to send their people from St. John to St. Thomas for an evening event. The only people who I would let off the hook for the summer trade would be the charter boats. But I'm hoping that if we can get this now instilled, that you do not, if you really want to say you're in business, you're not going to be closing your doors on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and you're going to find a new way to do business, I'm hoping that this will turn around.
David, don't give up on the concept. Maybe it's just one night. I mean, you've heard it all, I'm sure, but don't give up on the,
do
it could be
do
the
do
right.
Do it, Jazz in the park.
Yeah, it brings me to the question I wanted to pose as well. Have there been statistics to back out the need to open late at night, that you actually have these villa guests and hotel guests coming into town? Have there been surveys done that the merchants can look at the numbers? Because merchants, you know, they're number people. So they want some more factual information, I would suspect, in
it's
order to justify opening the stores. I mean, I currently have been doing pop-ups at Yacht Haven Grand. And even in the evenings, we don't get a whole lot of people there. So, you know, I think it would be awesome to have opportunities to go into town in the evenings to do shopping. But is there really a demand for it?
It's a chicken and egg kind of thing.
Yeah.
There are no marketing surveys because we haven't done it. We could do the marketing studies once it has been initiated. However, we have had, directly to me, the commitments from the villa companies and the hotels. Now, granted, it comes with conditions. And those are the conditions we're trying to fulfill.
But David, I go every year Christmas. Okay, how many people go every single year downtown for Christmas? Main Street, how many people go every year faithfully, okay? Faithfully, all right? I go faithfully. That has gone from being, okay, that has gone from being fabulous to I'm not giving up, I'm going, okay? But that has gone from being fabulous to tricky, okay? So I've gone from even going to merchants and saying to them, you've got to do something. So they serve wine, champagne, put food in their stores, so that it's really something worth going to. Because if you're going to market it, you got to market it. Something's there. But
and marketing is part of the key element to
I get
this.
It. But
you can't just put it out there.
No,
so.
But it's gotten really, like I said, I'm faithful. So. We're losing the one night we know we shop, okay, that everybody has to shop. We're already losing that sliding battle. And then we try to add a second night when we can't even put our first night, you know. I'm just saying that it's tricky when we can't get
but,
this room to go
okay,
on Christmas.
But here the conditions that the hotels gave us, because they're key. I'm going to reverse the list, and because of what you said, consistency. If we did it on a regular monthly basis, and what's the other element? Just a minute. I just want to get this thought out of my head. Variety of shopping. And. There too, we are trying to make a difference in that there is a group of 50 small businesses that are trying to establish operations in downtown, thanks to the help of the Economic Enterprise Zone program. One has opened, one is about to open, and they are looking for places. They are a variety of things. They're small businesses, but they have a variety of what they do. It will mix in with the other businesses we have and encourage people to go downtown and see what's there. Okay. I'm with Bill, you had a point.
Yeah. You had a point.
I had a point. How are you? Good afternoon. I have to say this in a different part, in a different point of view. I am not really annoyed, but I do work for the government, and I've been working for the government for over 30 years, so Mr. Bornn knows where I'm proceeding from. One point of view, as an example, when my wife and I, we go to the RICO Center, we're going to go to a particular event for a particular singer or whatever activity it might be. By the time we come out, it's already past 9:30, getting close to 10. Guess what? Usually, we all are involved with what's going on, and we're happy and everything else, and guess what? We want to extend. Where can we go to have at least something to eat before I go home? And I live out in the rural area. I am forced to go into town. And really, all the shops are closed after 9:30. Restaurants are closed before 10 o'clock. Probably you might get maybe a glass of water or maybe a glass of wine if the bar is still open, because some other event. This is just one example where business, I will probably just say, use your train of thought, use your creativity in a sense of there is an activity going on, you have a particular venue, well, advertise it, because usually RICO is being advertised in the newspaper and you know what event is going to be coming up, and maybe you can probably say, ah, guess what, my establishment is so and so, for the people who are attending the RICO Center for this particular event, we're going to open our hours a little bit later so that whoever would like to join us after the event of enjoying what we all went through, we can share it over in our establishment. And guess what? It's possible that somebody will show up, even myself, with my wife, and enjoy something after the activity, at least to eat before we can go home, maybe a drink, something, a little appetizer, or whatever the case may be. But this is just a thought that I can throw it out to you. And on another thought, I work for the Housing Finance Authority. Our agency is sending out comments. I'm plugging this because you hit the topic on revitalization. And I just wanted to utilize one of our venues that we have to offer for the public. We don't tend to advertise as much, but I believe that we should. And I'm taking this step in order to say it to everyone. We have under our umbrella that was removed from planning and natural resources, which is community development block. The block grant has been successful for over 40 years. We have been helping individuals to revitalize segments of different communities that you could channel. All it takes is to get the information. And the thing is, you can call our agency, and I'm happy to provide you with the number, which is 777-4432. And just ask for the section of CDBG. There are two ladies that works with us. One is an older lady, her name is Antoinette Fleming. And if she is not there, there is another lady, her name is Irene Acosta. Both of them, they are spearheaded in this particular program. It is a federal program, yes, but our funding are geared for revitalization regardless of the community that you are in. All it takes get the information from them, apply, and I'm going to give you examples of three that have gone through our particular services and that have been successful. One is the Family Resource Center, which is over by the end of Garden Street going up the Fork Road, a little bit further up. They have came to us in order for them to get funding because they need to house homeless people. They got their funding, and that went through. I believe it went over $20,000 or so. In Frederickson, there was a particular area, I'm not sure if it was Prince Street or whatever street it is, but they saw the building, it was dilapidated and everything else. And the Women's Coalition, they looked at it and they examined it and they went through our program and successfully they have rebuilt that building towards to revitalize Frederick State area and that particular street.
That's in King Street, I work right.
Okay. All right. And that was through our
funding.
Okay. And the other one is the one at the Market Square, the Methodist Outreach Center. They also came to us. They needed the funding before they used to be by the church. They needed the location so that they could work with this particular program. They came to us, they got the funding, and they have repaired that building that they're in right now across the pavilion at the Market Square. And it's successfully, it is working. All I need to add is this. You have to think of what you would like to do. What is it that you would like to promote? And I can guarantee if the plan is well thought through, you can get the funding from our particular program. I'm not sure what will be the amount that will be assigned for you, but that will all depend upon your scope, of course. You go through the process, and I guarantee you, after everything goes through, and you do get the funding from us, which we haven't lost our funding for the past 40 years, and we're still getting more funding because we are doing well.
What is your budget?
Excuse me?
How much do you have?
We get according to what they provide us. Right. Some people have gotten $200,000, $1.5 million. It can go up or it can go down, but the amount that we get, it is there to be used. And I'm just letting you all know to go ahead.
Can
and
the
try
government
it.
Tap into that for governmental loans?
Well, yeah. let me hear. After I finish, let me add this to it. And I guarantee you it will work. Why? If you do something for yourselves in order for the location and that you're planning or looking for a particular service, everything else just falls into play. People will come. I work in town from early morning and I wanted to leave. Why? Because I know there is no parking space. But after 6 o'clock. Yes, there is parking space. But what is there to do? Practically nothing. If there is something, well, I'll say, well, I'll stay. Or I go home and then come back. It goes either way. Now, adding on to what you were saying, our building that we're located in Frenchtown, the Frenchtown group got together and they took the community block grant and they built the bottom portion that you see today. Afterwards, you will understand where I'm coming from. Our agency, we were paying rent. We were at the Market Street, and then from there we went to Foster. And we were paying out of our ears the rent. Under the leadership of who is now Senator Grant, he was our director. Through his knowledge and through his way of maneuvering. The individuals that had that particular low structure which they're trying to set because of some other reasons, the agency bought it back. By buying it back, we build the upper part. And by building the upper part, we're owning the building. And I believe we were one of the first semi-autonomous agencies that we are owning our own property. We are not paying rent. And the lower portion is being used for commercial use. There is a barber shop. Now there is a nail and repairs for women. There was a travel agency. The other part, there was a outlet for whoever wanted to send anything to Tortola or to any other down island, whatever. So, and our structure is located at Frenchtown, right across the street from McDonald's. You can't miss it. It's the yellow building. And it's right next to the ballpark. So I was just plugging this to let you all know. I'm here to help whichever way I can. So all of this is free of charge.
Very good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah. My question though is that among the owners of buildings within the historic districts of town that are responsible for letting buildings deteriorate, the VI government is one of the owners that is one of the serial offenders. Most people won't say it with virtually everything that David has talked about and his perspectives. I have a little problem with how much it smacks of gentrification, because I don't necessarily feel that gentrification is a bad thing. I think it's needed as a means for urban renewal. But we all have to understand that in the political and social climate that we live in today in the Virgin Islands, there's an enormous amount of resistance to gentrification. So when everything is always packaged as if it seems like it's only looking out for the downtown merchants, that's a really hard sell to the popular public, you know. And it's also very hard for us to encourage private owners and private individuals to maintain and fix their derelict or older buildings in town when the Virgin Islands government owns a building right next door that they're allowing to deteriorate. And as David pointed out, we've come to the realization that we can't really rely on the government to fix our problems. I mean, we need to mobilize as a community to deal with these things. Okay. So my question was, we have this extremely historic building where the district court used to be, okay? It is deteriorating.
Don't forget the public library, David.
Well, yeah, but let me take this one for an example, because it's been brought up already, and it happens to be one that I'm particularly concerned with. Because it's an extremely historic building, but most people don't recognize it as one, okay? And there's a number of reasons for that. Number one is it falls on the very end of the Danish colonial framework that we normally have our mindset as that, well, this is historic architecture. The other thing is that because of that, it's a cast concrete building that a lot of people don't associate it with being historic. In fact, it was probably the first cast concrete building ever built in the Danish Coast Towns. But let's take that building for example. There is a lot of buzz within the community, particularly in government circles, that they want to tear that building down. And I've been told firsthand by a number of people that that building might just disappear one day, pretty soon. Okay. Some people feel that it's in the way for the waterfront project and the revitalization of the Vendors Plaza. Some people might, okay, for winding roads and so on. I don't know why. And of course, there's all these things that people don't like to talk openly about. But I don't know why there's the buzz that this building is in jeopardy, except for that some people claim that
that it has gotten to the point now where it's been neglected long enough that it's becoming a public hazard. Recently, plywood barrier was put around it, supposedly to keep people away from it out of it at carnival time because there are concrete chips falling out. There's other dynamics in play. But we
used to be a federal building.
Well, it is a federal building.
Ah, okay.
Then it's owned by the federal government, not the local government.
As far as we know, it is still owned by the federal government. Okay. It's on the National Register of Historic Places. In fact, it was one of the first buildings put on the National Register when the historic district was being set up, one of the very first. So it was acknowledged for its historic value at that time. Okay. But right now it has sat abandoned for 20 years or so. Okay. Is it possible to get a block grant to help restore that building?
Well, let me put it to you this way. Nothing is impossible.
Yes.
The only thing is this.
Yes.
It only takes a group of individuals who are really are interested, and I know that through this, I think we all are interested. If you cannot come to me, let me put it to you this way. You tell me where you're located, I will bring you our pamphlet. You can read up on it. I'll give you the name of the peoples. I'll give you the addresses, anything you need to know, and you take it from there. The reason behind it is that because I'm working within the agency, I have to remove myself because there will be conflict of interest. But that does not mean I cannot provide you with the information, I cannot provide you with anything that you need in order to make it easier for you, in order for you to spearhead and say, well, let me try them and let me see what I can do. And then from there, everything else, and I'm hoping that everything just falls into place.
Okay, but simply my question is there, right now, one of the problems that I think we're experiencing with that building is no one really wants to take responsibility for it, or knows. The VI government considers themselves responsible for it. Property procurement, I assume, thinks that they're responsible for it.
Did they put up the plywood?
Have they?
Who put up the
plan?
Public Works.
Yeah. Shall I?
Well,
can I respond to a lot of things that have come up?
Please.
I mean, start backwards and go for it. As for the old district works building, it is my understanding that the VI government, at least in its view, owns the building. And views the building as having structural and temporary issues. It is possible, and there has been an overture to lease the building, the site, to a private party for development of the site. Whether that private party uses CDBG money or uses private financing, up to them. And on that same building, the plans that I'm aware of were for the demolition of the building, for the construction of, or for the use of the site as a possible place for alternate location vendors. But the building itself is not in the way of the waterfront boulevard. The plaza where the vendors are now would become an open amphitheater
plaza.
That would incorporate not just an area for staging, but would have a water fountain incorporated as well. And the vendors would be removed from that. The whole premise of the waterfront boulevard and by the way, I'm using Boulevard very specifically. I've had to change my vocabulary about various things in town several times. One is there is no harbor, there is no water taxi. It's harbor transportation. The Waterfront Boulevard, we curve around outside the legislature point and come back in front of the post office, the police station. So I'm not sure where it's being attributed that the highway, the boulevard, would necessarily remove the...
No.
I understand.
You're answering my question.
There's plenty of misinformation and lots of things.
Yeah, well, you know how you get over misinformation? You put the right information.
So, there's one point I wanted to end with in terms of your point about restaurants. The interesting thing is that restaurants in other communities, and in particular, we don't have to look any further than Puerto Rico, they used the restaurants, the enhancement of the variety and the quality of the restaurants in their downtown areas as the catalyst,
yes,
as the starting point for the revitalization, instead of the opposite way of trying to bring other businesses to town. They started with the restaurants, and just as you're saying, people wanted to be out certain hours of the day, they wanted something to do, they wanted to have lunch. My great premise, if the biggest landlord in town used its buildings for government offices, it would be engendering further needs, including restaurants. Now,
and in Old San Juan, they do have the government offices, and all
exactly.
those people downtown, that's who they're.
Right.
And they would have to restore those buildings.
Exactly.
To a historic character.
Right.
Not demolish them and use them and
understood.
Totally convert them.
Right. To your point, just so you know, the government does engage in this positively. Two examples. One, the Department of Tourism wanted to come to town. It looked at two possible sites. One was the old police station that is now in Darrell State.
Where is that?
Next to the Fort Christian Park.
Thank you. Sonic Command.
It was to be incorporated, the restoration of that building was to be incorporated into the construction of the parking building. And the Tourism Department was considering going there in the restored building. Various reasons, the parking structure did not happen. All of the bidders backed out. So Tourism, still on a mission, we want to come to town, chose the site down behind the, over the USS. So, it's a state of mind. It is. Understandably, it's the person in charge, not just in charge of government house, but the person in charge of proper procurement, whose disposition is most important for the government to use its properties effectively as catalysts for revitalization. I think we have a winner, I hope. We have a winner in this new property procurement commission. He and I have had discussions. We've had discussions about the use of these government buildings. But time to talk. But I just wanted to hit that note in terms of the restaurant. Are there any other questions? Yes, sir.
Good evening. I'm a cognitive. Being about downtown. I used to live in St. Martin from since 1979. Up till 2008. I still have my business in St. Martin, so I'm back and forth between here because my wife is from here, but we met in St. Martin. When I've been to St. Martin in the beginning, to those of us that know St. Martin, before the French side opened up to restaurants, which is in the Grand Cass area, we're speaking when we were in Phillipsburg, what happened is you cannot attract open doors for jewelry to stay open at a certain door if there is nobody to really, in the daytime, as you said, people that come to visit the island, they want to have our sun bath. They want to also, there's so much they want to do. And not going to the jewel store. I understand those on the ship, they are also limited. So they mostly would live like those are on the ship to try to get the opportunity to shop to just in through the daytime. But what happened in the evening? Because of the restaurants, because so many people write to us asking, where can I get something to eat? There is no answer to these questions, because when you tell them, go to Victor's Hideout. Victor's Hideout is not located in downtown, you gotta go up. If there's an attraction where there is more restaurants, and I'm not speaking restaurants where you just get any and anybody just walking, that not buying but disturb the peace of, they come to beg, they come to rob. You got to get rid of these guys, but you got to attract those with good restaurants, that those that are in the hotels, because we have guests that are overnighting on their vacation, whether birthdays, weddings, etc. If you have attractive restaurants, it gives you an opportunity to keep the jewel stores, not one or two jewel stores open, because they must have a vision. Without a strategy in those vision, then it will abort the vision. In order to save the vision for birth to take place, it has to start somewhere. Who is willing to take that start? There are many of us in here. You have to get pregnant with something in order to give birth. And in order to do abort it, because winners cannot win and quitters cannot win. So in order to be a winner, you cannot quit. And because you win, it proves that you did not quit. But it must start somewhere. And you have to take some people with balls to say, hey, it's not going to happen overnight. So if you start tonight and you say, man, because I didn't make much money tonight, I cannot keep it up. You got to also get at least 100 people that goes to WAPA one time. You cannot have one person go to WAPA, because WAPA bill is one of the stuff, even in St. Croix, that closed down a lot of business place in the same Frederick State. If 100 people reach before the management of WAPA and say, we are about to do business, including the governor, have to be there. The problem about our business going to keep its door open, because of the price of utility, we're speaking about water and electricity, we as the people that come here before you need your help to see our vision. We are pregnant. That's why you go to an area like to get nursing, doctor, when a woman is pregnant, able to help her in the pregnancy, that it does not be abort. If WAPA and the governor, whoever would be sitting at whatever day, cannot see that because of the elevation, where the height of this bill, then these 100 people, they cannot function. Because when they just start, it got to take them sometime about 7 years before they can kick up in a certain manner, because they got to pay all government dues, they got to pay utility bills, there's so much a thing, and they got to pay their workers right, because if they doesn't pay their workers right, they cannot reach nowhere. But there are many of us in here, and we can still get more on board, that is willing to get pregnant, but we have to have a strategy. We must be able to face the utility, personnel, on what we want to do, and where we will, but the restaurants, we should be able to start there. But if the restaurant is not there, you cannot open the doors for jewelry, because people doesn't just come for jewelry.
Let me say something on that point. The couple of points that it raises. The restaurants also are a factor in terms of targeting residents, first and foremost, and overnight visitors. However, a little known fact, which we have been trying to promote. DRI, 4 years ago, managed to get the legislature to pass a bill that permits the cruise ships to remain in port after 5 and open the casinos only, not the strip, on board. The cruise lines, when we met with them after, I made a direct inquiry, are you aware of this, and what are you doing to implement it into your time schedule, your cruise schedule? First of all, they were not aware of it. Now they're aware. As you know, cruise schedules are made many years in advance, and so it is a question of factoring it into the schedule. However, they too said, yes, we want to do all of these infrastructure improvements. Improve the Main Street appearance, do harbor transportation, do something about the taxi allocation. What are you doing for us? If we're going to do these things and you have to have commitment to get these people off the boat, you said that people are staying on board the ship because they are afraid of coming off. We, St. Thomas, has the highest, what I call, leave back number in the entire Caribbean.
Really?
The passengers that miss the boat because they have a traffic problem. We did not only this effort to delay the departure, but we also instituted, with the help of the police department, WICO, Port Authority, and the Taxi Association, a study. This goes back about 4 years ago, three years ago, where the traffic the pattern in and out of WICO in the morning and in the afternoon was altered in terms of the opening of the back gate and having policemen on the ground, not the traffic lights. Surprise. The traffic flowed 100% better.
Really?
Problem? Follow up.
They still missed the boat.
No. they got, you know, when they were starting back at 3 o'clock, they got there by 3:30. They were early now. Problem? They did it. They also had a coordinated pattern of a dispatcher for the taxis at both WICO and Port Authority Crown Bay that dispatched so the taxis would go in opposite directions. In other words, everybody didn't end up at Drake City at the same time, nor did they end up at Coral World or Mountaintop. The pattern would be altered so they could actually get them to town at varying times. Problem? They did it for 2 months. Other point. If we were to enhance, this is another premise, if we were to enhance the, let me just finish on the cruise. So, this whole thing about changing the business hours, if we do get the cruise ships to stay late, we have to change not only our offerings, we have to change our business hours. Because if they're going to stay late, the stores can't stay open on board the ship. So you can't tell us that it's a problem because they buy the same merchandise on board. They're going to have to wait until the cruise ships leave port if in fact they want to buy on board. But we have to do things. We have to offer whatever it is, house tours, dinner tours, dinner theater, night scuba diving, dinner sailing. They want something to do. I'm saying these things that they're actually there saying, we'll do it, but you gotta give us a reason to do it. The other element is if we created more of a residential life downtown, you would have a 24/7 atmosphere, which in fact creates a security blanket. Because if you in fact have people in town, not just from 9 to 5, but now roaming into town every day, every night, all night, you have dramatically helped the security aspect of the town. So your point, well taken. Yes, we've got to give them something new if they're going to stay.
Yeah, because
so, I'm sorry, David, we'll do another 10 minutes of questions.
So we get WAPA to sponsor a late night and not a big event.
That's a very interesting concept.
And not a big event, not a lot of music, but the stores. And maybe not till 9 o'clock, but 7 o'clock. Do, you know, little step. Last month, every Friday night, the stores were open till 7. You know, and restaurants. And so there's the consistency. You get WAPA to sponsor it. They get some good PR for those 2 hours. It costs less for them to be open.
Dave, back on that. I think that's gonna go down that line. In DC, believe it or not, DC has some of the similar issues of bringing. And in certain times of the year, they have restaurant nights. It's called restaurant nights. And they promote the hell out of it. And the restaurants have to buy in. It's a discount across the board. Or they have prefix menus that are very attractive. So you put that in Whopper, sell that to the cruise ships, and they're open. We have restaurants. By the way, are you in DRI? Yeah. Are you part of the organization?
No.
We have the restaurants. We can start with what we have. We have very good restaurants.
Yeah.
That are very good. They get acclaimed all the time. Condoleezza Travel and so on. And St. Martin, Phillipsburg is open at night now. And in fact, Phillipsburg has 2 restaurants that were opened by former restaurateurs from here.
Yeah.
They chucked here and they went there. I walked into the restaurant and he said, oh, Mr. Bornn, how are you? Okay. So it's doable. The thing about St. Martin we don't want to follow on is what we got going on here, and I say it till I'm blue in the face. We have to stop thinking cruise ships. And we have to think overnight guests. Because the cruise ship visitors are not the demographic we used to have. They cannot afford dinner at night. They can hardly afford the taxi for dinner. The overnight guest spends twice what the cruise ship visitor spends.
Even
and that's a no fact.
Per day.
And even in the store.
Per day. So you have to go, who has the discretionary income in their pocket?
Yeah.
And you have the Atrius Alley restaurant that's open. You have Maynard restaurants. You have the tavern restaurant. You have, do you know the greenhouse closes at 8 or 9 o'clock now?
9. Really?
Like, get out of town.
Virgilio's.
So, the market is in the hotels. Now, are you guys aware that Cushion Set Jump Up is very successful? And everybody trashes Cushion Set Jump Up? What are they doing right and we're doing wrong? It's a consistent event, and it is a wonderful event to see everybody out, restaurants open, stores open, people buying in stores, the stores are all open, they drop their prices for Jump Up Night.
Is that once a month?
Thursday or one, too.
Okay. What are they doing right? What about Ardmore?
Thursday.
Art
Walk is very successful.
Yeah, we used to have an art walk. What happened to that? So, I think we ought to. I want to submit to you, I can help you with it. Restaurant nights.
Yeah.
It's a very simple concept. We've got restaurants. Okay. You go from Frenchtown all over to Yachthaven up to Blueberry.
Steve, it costs the hotel guests like $50 or $100 depending on the number of people to go from
solution.
Hotel downtown.
Solution has been
good. You said you were talking
about it. Because we got Parker.
We have an organization that has stepped up to the plate and has offered on non-cruise ship days and evening events to give a discount package Whether it's from the pillows or the hotels.
Because that's so expensive.
A couple of people, including yourself, have mentioned that the government is responsible for a lot of the buildings that are deteriorating in the downtown area. And we have a lot of government offices that are renting private sector spaces. And that seems to have been a trend, and I don't know if it's a political trend, to do so, to outsource our government offices to private sector renters. Is there a process or an established law or protocol that DPNR has prior to assessing a government entity or allow that government entity to use a private sector versus using a historical building that's in disrepair that they can?
No, it's an entirely a policy decision of each administration, whether they want to go private sector building or their own. And they'll tell you that they want to go into a private sector building because it's established or it's built out.
So can there be legislation to try to persuade the government to consider either
the better thing is to try to work is to what we do, facilitate, is to get that conversation going with the government via the commissioners and the governor. The governor has said to me that he does intend to try to bring back more offices to town. But the conversation has to be had with DPW and procurement, that in fact they do that.
Now, is the perception correct though, that a lot of the times these things happen for political favors?
Yes. Plain and simple, yes.
Not unusual.
So I think we have time for maybe two more questions. Courtney, you have one question as well?
And then, yeah, what I was sharing at first, which I know it was still misinterpreted, I was not making a statement that we have to only cater for the cushy, because St. Martin does not cater for cushy only. What about when there's a season when we have no cushy? What I'm saying is in Grand Cas, we had no restaurants before. Grand Cas have over 120 restaurants. Because restaurants are open, those that are
over
90,
the
stores are open because people come to eat. During the time they finish it and not yet ready to go back to their hotel, they can shop around what they do not get chance to do because they take out
some
back.
It is not just in St. Martin, it is elsewhere.
It's happening.
Rocky Bay solution.
Yeah.
Friday night, go to Lake. Yeah. Every Friday night, go to Lake.
Because they're all into developing
French
hotel town. Rooms. Yeah. Developing.
French town says Porcelain. You know, Martinique, downtown, in front of France.
Look how much growth.
Every Saturday night.
So, tell you what, don't go too far.
But
on this side, I was a youngster. I believe this gentleman here was a youngster, and a few of our friends. We used to eat in Crazy Cow.
2-3 o'clock in the morning.
And everybody was hanging out and having a wonderful time.
And it's good food.
I know, I don't know anything about that.
When I realized that this island had a lot to offer. Unfortunately, of course, Crazy Cow already had passed away.
Okay, you're the last one.
Okay.
You know, because I must have been in the wrong building, because I thought the name of this presentation was Preservation and Possibilities. Okay. And I really haven't heard us address preservation very much.
You weren't here today when I said David.
Yeah, well, wait a second. I did come in, okay, at a point where you made a comment that preservation regulation sometimes are a hindrance to people rebuilding or doing their structures.
I don't disagree with you. Let's start there, okay? So I think as a community, one of the reasons I thought the trust was doing this series was to open a dialogue about preservation and how we're going to look at and deal with preservation as a community, because we have problems, you know? A lot of what you've said tonight to me just echoes basically what I said last week. It's a conundrum, you know?
Yeah.
We've got more problems. We're full of ideas. Everybody in this room has good ideas. But what we're not doing is we're not getting to the bottom of how you break the syndrome, start thinking differently, and start working towards something better, not just micromanagement or worrying about, you know, business interests or security or something. We've got a bigger problem. You know? We've got a bigger problem. Okay, so I'm going to ask you first, do you think we would be able to streamline our revitalization process downtown if we, to some degree, deregulated the historic district? Okay, that's number one. Okay. Was that an answer?
Yes, the answer is no. The answer is no, you would not streamline.
Okay.
Let me make this very clear. Mm-hmm. I am not saying that in the name of revitalization, you abandon preservation. I am saying that preservation and revitalization can coexist, but there are times when in the effort to revitalize, you cannot adhere to strict preservation rules because you're not going to get to the point of revitalization. Revitalization, understandably, is not necessarily the physical environment, and it is not the physical environment of historical content. It is the appearance and attraction of the area to life, to doing business, and to residents, and to entertainment. Can you have, for instance, entertainment in a historical building? Absolutely. Can you demolish a historic building in the name of putting something more current in? Perhaps. But the element is that you are trying to drive the use and attraction of the town, which has a long, long history, back into a desirable place to be. How many people do you know that will say, downtown? Oh, no. You could drag me to downtown if you tied me to the back of the car. Why do we have that attitude? Because there are elements that we have to eliminate, but to eliminate in the sense of making better, that do make the town attractive. And that is not necessarily an historical preservation process. But it is, and it is not just physical.
Yeah,
but I have to really emphasize that it is not just the physical environment.
Yeah.
It is the whole atmosphere of what goes on in the town, which is why, for instance, security, which has nothing to do with preservation, security is in such an important area.
Quick one for you. I know one of the larger issues facing downtown Shawang is it's COVID. And a lot of the buildings, a lot of folks, they aren't sure who owns it or where the owners are located or anything like that. Is the government, with revitalizing downtown, is there something that they plan on doing as far as streamlining the probate issue or even looking through the laws to figure out exactly who owns particular buildings, so we can start from that?
That is a process that is beyond our capabilities, but it is being attempted to be solved by the Enterprise Zone program.
Okay, thank you. Then.
I gotta finish the talk.
One more thought.
I think one of the things we're missing, and I think one of the things that
our community and all our organizations need to really deeply consider and figure out how we're going to work with the guidelines up is the fact that we have federally regulated national historic district in town. And when people come to the Historic Preservation Commission and want the Historic Preservation Commission to bend here and bend there and give them a little leeway here, what they fail to realize is that that's a regulatory body that's being held to a set of rules and guidelines that are not arbitrary, you know? And I think a lot of times we look at the Historic Preservation Commission as being something that's resistant to development or revitalization.
Let me say this. It's a very short answer to what you're saying. What you're saying all has merit, but it has to be made part of the conversation. Because preservation goes into the whole attraction of the town. If we had it, you know, people go to Fredrickstead and Umutanam. If we had an understanding, which a lot of people in downtown don't, that the attraction of the town and the harbor together is its historical nature. And you need to continue that fabric. It would be incorporated into revitalization. But you can't do one or the other, revitalization or conservation, without having that conversation.
Right. So,
and that's what we are trying to foster.
Okay, well, I've been on the Historic Preservation Commission for 2 years, and I have never, at that time, seen us have any meaningful interaction with the downtown revitalization.
We had plenty of interaction previous to that. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, they were an integral part of the conversation I talked about with Main Street Resolution. And yes, we haven't had that conversation, we need to have it, but frankly, there has been so much on our plate between the waterfront and the Main Street project, and people screaming and yelling about do we want to open late or not open late, that we haven't had time.
David, where did that communication break down?
I say both sides.
Okay. Can we work on it?
I will make that recommendation.
Me too.
Thanks, David.
Perfect.
Thank you
so much.
David, I'd seen her if you were to come up here. We also have something for you for your
opening my big mouth.
You're a wonderful dancer.
Going around there, which way are you going?
And
there, thank you.
This lecture series, I'd like to introduce thank you to our Historical Trust board members. Gail is part of her brainchild to put this together, as well as David and I seen her. And this came out of a conversation that they both had. And Gail was the same thing.
I just want to say thank you all very much for coming and supporting this conversation. Steve was just saying what's important is that we're having the conversation. And many different voices are heard. We don't all agree, but we're having the conversation. That's how we get to where your vision is taking us. So I'm also a big believer in consistency. So we will keep doing this.
Well, I thank you for making the overture. And it's not me. This is about us. And I unfortunately feel that DRI has become a little too personal to me, and it's one of the reasons that I am leaving the board, because you have to take over. This is not a me project, and if we as a community don't do this because we want to do it, it's not going to happen. Thank you.